Very good evening. Many thanks for joining us on State of Affairs. My name is Kweku Temin. Tonight, I sit in for Nanaba Anamoa. We're bringing you details of issues making headlines in the country. And then tonight, we'll dovetail ourselves into something that is making real headlines. And I talk about the tourism industry. Indeed, we've had a fantastic time in the Kwewu regions, that's the Eastern region, enjoying every bit of the festivities. But do we go to rest afterwards? Is that the end of it? Are we to do more, or as a people, can we do more to rake in more revenue? Indeed, what is the state of the tourism industry in Ghana today? What is the mandate of the ministry? What are some of the things that they should be able to share with us as a people so that we can all focus on the tourism industry? Our revenue that we are raking, that's for our contributions to GDP. Is it quite enough? We'll talk about this and other interesting details as we get some guests joining us. But for now, let me just take some news items. Now I'll quickly look at some stories making headlines before we go into our main discussions this evening. Now, the Bureau of National Investigations, that's the BNI, has released Captain Retired Edmond Koda, the head of the private security detail of the New Patriotic Party's flag bearer, Nana Adodankwa Akufo-Addo. The ex-serviceman has been in the BNI custody since Thursday over his alleged role in the invitation of three ex-police officers from South Africa to train the internal security personnel of the party. Now, information reaching EIB indicates that Captain Koda, who fell ill while within the confines of the fortified edifice, was released today ahead of a planned demonstration by aggrieved supporters of the New Patriotic Party to demand his freedom. The 69-year-old was rearrested on Thursday after charges of unlawful training and conspiracy to commit crime against him were dropped. His Wager residence was allegedly raided by the national security operatives. So Captain Koda, around this time, has been released from the BNI custody. We'll take other stories. And your authorities at the Rich Hospital here in Accra have assured of safety of patients at the facility following reports of an armed robbery attack over the weekend. Also, the armed robbery attack happened over the weekend. It's thrown them into a state of fear. Now, robbers reportedly made away with some items belonging to staff on duty at the time. Director of the Rich Hospital, Dr. Thomas Anaba, however, told EIB Star FM News that the incident is being exaggerated. Dr. Anaba added that there will be a meeting tomorrow, Tuesday, with the heads of departments and also security officials at the hospital to review the security setup of the facility. So we'll be getting some more details of this particular development tomorrow when they have the meetings with the head of departments and the security apparatus. But yes, EIB has represented so strong in Kwewu. We'll bring you some news coming up from the area. And tonight we promise to also get some more discussions of activities around Kwewu. Now, this year's Kwewu Easter festivity was graced by the usual heart-throbbing paragliding exercise, having for the first time in 11 years, a Ghanaian paraglider. So yes, we've graduated. We're picking up the trade. The 11th exercise began on Friday, March 25, and ended yesterday, that is Sunday, March 27. Prior to that, Ajua Sapon of GH1 TV spoke to the Eastern Regional Tourism Chairman, Rudolph Ajay, about the paragliding experience.
It started about 11 years ago. What actually happened was that I think the late Honorable Jacob Tebilante came to Kwewu, and on one of his expeditions in Kwewu, he realized that, no, this event can take up here. So he had this gentleman from South Africa, Walter, who used to be the lead pilot then. They went to survey the site, that is the Ojoanuma Mountains, and they realized, no, the place is conducive for paragliding. They did some test runs, and knowing Jake, who he used to be, he saw the potential in that, and that was how the paragliding was instituted. Paragliding is a kind of air sport. We have two types. We have the tandem. The tandem is the one that the pilot will carry a passenger and then they will fly. And we have the solo flight, which is just for one person, the pilot would. What the tandem is the most exciting one because that is the one that people can patronize. So a pilot harnesses a passenger onto what is like a parachute with wings. The trick behind it is that you should be able to run fast as you descend the cliff. And just as about you are getting to the edge of the cliff, the tandem lifts you up and then you start gliding. That is just, it sounds very simple, but when you are doing it for the very first time, you'll be a little bit scared. But I tell you, the moment you take off is so spectacular.
So have you at any point in time actually done a paragliding?
The very first paragliding I was in air, the second I was in air, the third I was in air. And as you can see, I started gaining weight, so I decided to stop.
So is it something that you have to be a specific body weight to be able to do?
Yes, depending on the weight of the pilot. I think both weight of the pilot and the passenger shouldn't exceed, I think, either 160 or 170. So, for instance, if a pilot wants to take you, then you have to go for a pilot with a lower weight because, as I can see you, you also have. So that they have a maximum weight depending on the wings of the tandem. Okay. Yeah.
Interesting times. So Rudolph Ejay is the Eastern Regional Chairman of Tourism. Well, he briefed my colleague earlier on, Ajua Sapon of GH1 TV, on the paragliding experience. So the big question is, well, the Kwewu festivities over. Is that the end of paragliding? Are we not able to entertain tourists to the streets if they come into the country? Can we not think about hiking in Kwewu? Tonight, we would want to get more details on it. But let me just quickly move into one final story. And when we tell you that we will do it, we'll deliver on our promise. I'm talking about Star FM, Live FM, Kasapa, Ago, GH1. Yes, the group came together. I'm talking about the EIB network. We lived up to our promise of lighting up Kwewu this Easter, from the Akwaba Bash on Thursday, March 24th, through to a night of high life performance on Sunday, March 27th. Thousands of people were treated to some entertainment. We'll catch a glimpse of some of the activities there.
No go find, I go put it to you. Now the one thing I want you to do, I go give it to you. Zio, why is that this? Oh, I build your feel.
All right, so those were some of the interesting times in and around Kwewu. It is over now. And you're welcome back into the studio. If you're just joining us, it's still State of Affairs. We're discussing some of the topical issues making headlines in the country. We'll take a break shortly. When we come back, we'll move deep into tourism. Around this time, what can we do for the sector? What can we do for the industry? Could it contribute even more to the GDP of the country? When we come back, I'll introduce my guest to you and we'll share more time on the tourism sector. We'll be back shortly. Do stay with us. We'll be right back. All right, so we're grateful that you've still kept faith with us here on GH1 TV. We're bringing you some quick facts about the tourism sector, and that would launch us deep into the discussion. So just take it, it's on your screen shortly. All right, so early on, I introduced some few issues that as a nation we should critically look at. The euphoria, the excitement around the Kwewu festivities is over now. At the end of the day, the big question is, are we not able to rake in more revenue from the entire Kwewu area? Look at the mountains. Look at the tourism potential of the area. We should be questioning ourselves. And indeed, what is the plan of the ministry for that region? That matter, moving deep into tourism, what are we looking at? Could we introduce systematic steps that would help us as a nation rake in more revenue or significant contributions to the GDP? Well, just the slides gone by, you saw some contributions that tourism had made to the country's GDP. Very shortly, we will just get into detailed discussions on some of these issues. But let me just quickly introduce my guest here in the studio. He's a man that I've always had time with anytime we would get to talk about critical issues. He's no strange face, Dr. Bernard Otabel. He's the CEO of the Ghana News Agency. Tonight he's joining us to deliberate with us on his take on the tourism sector. I have a very good friend also in the studio who I would want to introduce him. Indeed, Pa John Bentifi is a tourism advocate, but even more seriously, he's the principal of the Sea Ghana Domestic Tourism Crusade. Now, this organization is looking at projecting domestic tourism. Indeed, as an individual, how many times do you get to move from your busy work schedule, visit somewhere in Kumasi, visit Mesia, and try to find out indeed the history behind the palace? I bet you've been working for several years. You've never thought about that. But gentlemen, let me say you're very much welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
I'm glad to have every one of you here. I'll move straight into details. And maybe let me find out from Dr. Otabel. You have traveled wide. Are we serious about tourism in this country?
That's a very straight question. Yes, I would say that we are serious about tourism. If you look at what we've done over the years, I mean, in 1996, actually, we launched the 15-year tourism development plan, which actually ended at the end of 2010. Then following on from there, we had the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, we had a UNDP, and the World Trade Organization, World Tourism Organization, sorry, the UNWTO, as well as our own ministry coming together to devise another 15-year development plan, which runs from 2013 up to 2027. Now, if you look at the key indicators within this, you know, particular plan, you would actually see that there's a lot that the ministry is looking at, or us, you know, as a country, we're looking at how we can develop the tourism sector to make it much more vibrant. But then, if you look at the summary, the executive summary of that particular plan, it also talks about the fact that, indeed, in order for us to really actualize what we've put down in this particular plan, there's a need for, you know, the kind of will from the government. That means that the government would have to own it and be prepared to play that particular role of spearheading the development of the tourism sector. Now, if you're looking at a sector that is actually estimated to be contributing about 4.3 billion in terms of receipts by 2027, you know, mind you, we're looking at 1.5 5 billion by the end of 2017 and so on and so forth. Then, of course, we have looked at it in a very, very, you know, composite way. And I would say that, yes, there's some element of seriousness in that.
Some element of seriousness, but a lot of paperwork. Now, you for lining, I'll get you to a man who is practical on the field, who is thinking about getting the young men to visit their own tourist site. Pajon, a very good evening. I'm glad you are here. Maybe before I get into details with you, let me let viewers appreciate what you are doing when it comes to See Ghana. What is it about?
Well, See Ghana is a domestic tourism crusade, as you said. This is a project that I started with Joy FM last year. And what we did was every month from March, we organized a trip and put it out on radio. So it's speculative, you don't have a group. So you put it out on radio and put out a date and expect people to buy tickets and join. And this is very, very difficult to do because on the day of the event, starting from the day you start talking, you're going
about
to go.
It.
200 people say, I want to go. But on the day, you have one person. And still, we went. You know, so taking people around the country to every region, to attractions, one attraction in every region. And we managed to do 6 regions last year. And we've just launched this year's crusade. Over the weekend, we did Kwewu. And like we say, there's a whole lot to Kwewu than just paragliding and young men and women reveling in the street dancing, you know. This year's Kwewu was very big, also because there was the added celebration of the 25th anniversary of the Chief of Obo. So you had a lot of bigwigs going there and making the whole celebration far bigger than it's been in the past years.
Of course, you had EIB Strong there.
Strong
we
either,
crusaded,
exactly.
We campaigned.
I mean, as soon as you enter the towns, you're going up the hill, you enter the towns, there is EIB, you see.
EIB Strong. We'll live
everywhere.
Up to the expectation. And my boss, Bolare, I'm sure, is watching.
But yes, there's a whole lot to Kwewu. And what See Ghana does, this year we're working together. It's a marketing, tourism marketing alliance between Joy FM, Joy Prime, and Multi TV.
I won't be surprised if you have all the stations and
the
EIB
Mirror,
coming up on board.
The
okay.
Mirror. Last year, EIB supported us. With Star FM supported us a great deal.
Do come back again, but I'm now going to go detail.
Yes.
Now, I've had Dr. Otabel mention how serious he thinks government is on this whole tourism agenda, and mentioned Agenda 2027 and some few others and the revenue targets. I dare say that this is paperwork. You are on the field.
So there are two people. One says yes, one says no, or what? Yes, there's a lot happening. But like you're saying, we're the ones on the ground, the layman. We do not look at the big picture. We want to see what's going on the ground. We want to see toilet facilities at the attractions. We want to see the road leading up to the attractions being fixed. We want to see added value to the attractions. When you go to the monkey sanctuary, what is there? Can you get a good place to urinate, for instance? When you go to Kakum, it's a nice facility. Is it holistic? Do you get excited, you know, apart from going through the canopy walkway, when you come, is the restaurant good?
No, those are questions I should be asking you.
Absolutely.
I mean, you go
and
there.
Do you have the urine out there? There aren't.
There's no, it's not there.
Not all the facilities.
Mm. The road there, is it good?
It's not good. Some of them are not good. Some are very good. You know, the questions are plenty. And we need to look at those questions holistically and find where we, you know, because, for instance, a road. Is it the mandate of the ministry to put a road, for instance?
Again,
I don't think so.
Can't blame the tourism minister.
Absolutely.
That the road is not looking good.
Absolutely.
I'm sure Dr. Otabel will come to some of these developments.
So the questions are plenty, and we have to start from somewhere, and we have to take it systematically. But like you said, there's a whole lot happening in the Kwewu region alone, even. There's a group there called the Kwewu Tourism Initiative. They've identified several new sites that they are developing into tourism attractions. Mm. The ministry has acknowledged some of them, and the ministry actually works with some of them. And over the weekend, we noticed that they had a stand at the paragliding reception area where they were selling tours and taking people on these tours. I had a group of about 14 people on the Sea Ghana trip to the paragliding area. We got there early enough. We had you know, something to eat, and then we went on a tour. We bought a tour. There was a hike. The ridge, Itibie, is very high up on the ridge that you see when you're driving to Kumasi and you get to Nkoko. You see this high ridge mountain there. We're on top of that mountain, and we hiked down, you know, a few kilometers down to a cave, you know, where you can get to sit and have a view, a very, very interesting, exciting view of Nkoko Township and some of the other townships there.
I'll give you the opportunity in a while so that you mention that page so that people can actually appreciate some of the pictures. But give me some time to go to Dr. Otabel to talk about tourism revenue. I mean, there's been a situation where government is raking in some revenue because of legislation that it put in. Let me even come to Kwewu. I mean, I've been nosing around. I know to paraglide, you're paying as much as 250 Ghana cedis. Of course, that is good money to go in the air with. It could probably be your air ticket, starboard to another area. But we ask, so where is the revenue going to? How are we replying the money back into the sector? I mean, if you've been finding out, can you help me with some answers?
Well, what I can say is pretty simple. And just before I go there, let me contribute to what my good friend was, you know, Pajon was trying to say. Now, if you look at the problems within the tourism sector, it's just symptomatic of the problems that we face in this country.
Yeah.
I mean, lack of effective, as he said, or holistic way of managing some of these, you know, facilities that we need to have. I mean, the tourism.
Would you put the blame on government or the individuals, the township, the DCE? Who should carry the blame? Because we should lay it at the doorstep of somebody.
Not necessarily, because you're looking at the supply and value chain approach. In the tourism sector, you're looking at restaurants, hoteliers, you're looking at car park attendants, you're looking at tour guides, you're looking at people like, you know, Pajon, who would actually be organizing the tourists and taking them to where they need to be.
You can tell him plainly that he should also carry part of the blame.
So there is some element of recognition in terms of what private sector is expected to do and what the government is expected to do. The government is the enabler, no doubt about that. I mean, there are some elements, you know, within the sector that you would want the government, no doubt, you know, to take that up. I mean, both local authority and the national authority. Now, some infrastructure will have to be provided, some basics we have to be made available. But when you're looking at the restaurants and all the other associated facilities that tourists would need, I mean, government have no business going into that.
Would you then say that the private sector has failed one way or the other? You can compare it to Malaysia, where individual businessmen, where the private sector, where people like Pajon will steady and guide you and give you the detailed topography of the area and let you understand that, look, I am learned and I know exactly what I'm talking about. Where people will study to the university level. So when they are speaking, they know exactly what they are talking about. Would you say the private sector then has failed one way or the other and we should not blame only the government?
Well, private sector investors are what we call the bargain hunting investors. They look for bargains. Now, before a private sector guy would say, look, I want to put my money into this, there is an earned expected. They do a bit of future pacing. They want an expected revenue at the end of the day. Now, if the government is not putting in the right infrastructure and the private sector person knows that if I put up this hotel, I would have to charge less because the facilities wouldn't be so good for people to waste that, you know, number of hours to travel to my hotel and so on and so forth. So it's kind of a catch-22 situation, a more or less a give and take, you know, kind of stuff. But then if you look at the tourism sector, you know, as a whole, if you take a holistic view, look, if you take out the receipt from exports and remittances, tourism is the third. You know, and these statistics are well documented. Now, in terms of foreign exchange earning, I must, you know, qualify that. Now, if you look at the whole services sector, in terms of our GDP, I mean, at the time of independence, agriculture was over 50%. Now, agriculture is about 25% thereabout, and services sector over 50%, with industry right behind. Agriculture about 21% thereabout, if you look at the, you know, the latest figures. So the tourism sector is not something that we can easily, you know, forget about. Now, look at the global receipts, you know, in terms of tourism.
I would be mentioning the
United Nations, you know, World Tourism Organization is looking at 1.5 trillion you know, dollars in 2014 alone. Now, China has moved up from the fifth position to the third. Now, if you look at the United States and Spain as the world's best, you know, in terms of revenue generation from tourism, then it should really be telling you something. Now, my take here is pretty simple. If you're looking at the number of countries that are making so much money or so much revenue from tourism, and most of them are the industrialized countries that we know, then of course there must be some level of enabling, you know, conditions that would also facilitate the, you know, the private sector, you know, operator to recognize that indeed there is something in there, and as a bargain hunting investor, I should have the rich pickings out of it.
Well, Pa, let me come to you. He said it right. But I once I put the question across about the private sector, I saw all the reactions from your fingertip.
Yes.
Maybe in doing so too, you can direct us to the page where we can see some of the images.
Well, Pa John Bentifi Datsun, I posted images of the trip we did over the weekend. So if you go there on Facebook, Pa John Bentifi Datsun. I have a website, bentifi.com. I haven't posted the pictures there yet. But if you go to my Facebook page, Pa John Bentifi Datsun, you will see some of the images that we took in the Kwewu area. We went to a waterfall. We went to there's a warrior cave. This is a warrior cave where the warriors of Kwewu would hide the women and children in the days when they were fighting with the Ashanti. And the Ashanti would come and not see anybody in the communities, but they would have been hiding in this cave. And they wouldn't, the Ashantis wouldn't know, and the warriors would be, they would ambush them and defeat them. This is a fascinating place to go to. And yesterday, the interesting thing that I've done, it's a hike and a bit of a struggle, you know, so my thighs are all hurting. But I've done it about three times already. So yesterday, I didn't go. But there were some young men from who come from Kwewu, who live in Accra, who had just come, and their relatives took them. They were mad. They were like, why aren't you promoting this thing?
It brings me to the question, should Kwewu die? Should after the Easter festivities, should we go dormant?
You know what I'll say to you? There are people in Kwewu who believe in what they have, and they will not let it die. They're working night and day to bring it to the fore.
Have you heard any of the stories of them moving? Are they approaching the
ministry? I have.
Do you think they can do something?
They're working. They've spent so much money, and I don't believe that the kind of money, you see, with the kind of money that they've spent, they will let it die. You know, these caves I'm talking about, for instance, they're sacred caves. The authority in terms of the chiefs were holding onto these places, and they wouldn't even let anybody go near there because it's a sacred place for the community, for the people, you know. But the tourism initiative, the Kwewu Tourism Initiative guys have worked over years with the chiefs and the people, and have managed to get them to come down,
loosen up a little bit,
you know. And now people can go there and experience these things. You know, when you're going in there, it's very dark. You hold on to ropes and climb. You're wearing a headlamp, you know, like a miner. And you get in there and you switch on your lamp. And it's a very narrow avenue to walk on rocks through and come out. And this is the Nkofiehu Warrior Cave in Eshwerinso, one of the towns, you know, from Obo. There is the where the paragliding happens. Like I was telling you, we were on the top of that ridge. We were able to hike down and go to some cave down there. And then there was this beautiful view of Nkoko Township and some other townships there.
The question comes back again. So we've gone in there, enjoyed ourselves, made a lot of money, dumped a lot of money also around the area.
Yes.
Where does the funds go to? Are we going to pick it, reinvest in the tourism ministry to disburse it across, or is money that should be kept in the area to develop tourism in the area?
I would say that that should be money that should be left in the area for it to develop the attraction that they have. But is that what happens? These are some of the...
Tell me, what's your idea of where the funds go to?
Could I even say where I know... 250. That goes to that the paragliding is organized by the Ministry of Tourism and the Ghana Tourism Authority. So they're the best people who can tell you where that money goes to. But you know,
I'm sure
the pilots
to give me, can you give
the
me
the pilots who come, the 10 pilots who came from abroad. They're not local.
There's now one local one.
One local pilot.
Can we take advantage?
Yes, and for him to also train others to get certification. It's a big... And all that money could even go to their flights and hotel and fees.
Are you worried?
I'm very worried.
Are you disturbed?
Extremely.
Does this trouble you?
I can't sleep over these things. And that's why, you know, we're trying to find the best avenue of getting some of these questions answered. Because there's no one set of answer, like my colleague here was saying. It's a big deal, and we need to engage all the players in the industry, from the ministry, through the private sector, through the communities. Everyone should be able to say, this is what we have in our community. Mm. This is what we can make out of it. This is what we're making out of it. This is what's coming to us. This is what's going to government. And this is what we're going to be doing with what we have. Until you engage the people who actually own the facilities and help them to develop it, you know, I don't know where we'll be going. The story is just going
ponder
to be
ponder like over this. It, where we'll be going, and I'll come back. Dr. Otabel, you've traveled wide. In UK, I joined a class in Plymouth, and... You know, it's a geography class, and they would look at their mountains. That, well, I went in there, I didn't see anything. They would tell you about the rocks, but it's even part of your curricula to just walk, hike up there, and study the rocks. I mean, in Ghana, you sit in classrooms where you know you only taught the sedimentary rock and the like, and it's paper. But you don't go out there and see the practical one. I don't know. I didn't do it as a course as an elective subject, but. Tell me about the best practice. What can really make tourism work in this country?
Well, I mean, what can really make tourism work in this country? I mean, I think what we can be looking at is in-country tourism. Now, in-country tourism is exactly what happens during the festive period of Easter. Now, you have a lot of people going down to Kwewu because they associate Easter to Kwewu. Okay. And that is why you get all the success stories that he's talking about in Kwewu. Now, thereafter, we all get back to our various places and nothing else happens. Now, one of the things that I would say, if you're looking at the experience that I have, for instance, President Jammeh used to have, or I think he still runs, a festival in his hometown called the Kani Life Festival, which I have, you know, actually attended before. Now, when
that's
you go to
Yahya Jammeh's festival.
Jammeh's festival.
In his hometown.
In his hometown. Now, if you go in, I mean, even the road to the place was just, you know, it's just terrible. You use the North Bank through Barra, you cross over, use a ferry, and then you drive on these, you know, treacherous roads. But yet you are so determined, you know, to go to the festival because there's a lot that happens at the place. Now, if you look at it from that point of view, you would say that this has some level of government or a presidential, you know, promotion.
That's right.
And therefore people are looking forward to it. Now, one of the challenges that we have in this country is a high cost of accommodation hotels. Now, if I'm going to Gambia from the UK, for example, I go on Monarch Air. I book my flight plus my accommodation, 7 day stay, whatnot, and all of that. I don't need to worry about anything else. I get in there, and if you do the calculation, you realize that, look, indeed, you're paying about $30-$40 a night for the facility that you have in. In the UK, there's a lot of what? You know, in-country tourism, for the simple reason that you have battlings and, you know, you may call it, you know, a low-cost kind of holiday, you know, kind of thing. But you go on a caravan and all that. Go to Cornwall, go to Gretna Green, go to Blackpool. And when you go there, there's a lot that is really happening there. Recently, and as you rightly pointed out, in my stay in China for about 2 weeks in November, where we visited the Black Wall, visited the Kung Fu Theater and all of that, we had to sit in a classroom where the history of China was actually taught. And some few words in China, how you can get about before you hit the street.
Just
and then
share one
now,
with me. Did you keep one in your memory?
Well, I kept a lot in my memory.
But say a word in China. At least let the Chinese community, they watch us here on GH1.
Ni hao.
At least. And that is, how are you doing?
How are you?
Awesome. So you meet a Chinese man, ni hao. And a person will be interested in you, at least.
No, I mean, basically, it's just sort of what we describe here. If you look at our 15-year plan now, 2015-2027, one of the key principles there is national cohesion. Mm. Now, towards cultural understanding. Now, if you go to Kwewu, you get to know how the people live. You mentioned Bentivi and all those. Yes.
The waterfalls and the...
You get to understand people in a different way. Now, in Widiba, where they used to have the Deer Hunt Festival.
Yeah.
Now, during that period in May.
It was a good one when I was
you would also, yes, but of course, you have a lot of chieftaincy disputes, over the years, and that actually also took it back a bit. You know, in central region where you have a lot of these chieftaincy disputes and so on and so forth, most of the tourism site cannot be developed simply because you may have problems here and there that will prevent tourists from going to those places. Now, in order for us to develop the sector in a very holistic way, it calls for all of us, chiefs, traditional rulers, the duty bearers, all those at the community level, to recognize that indeed, when people come here, they spend money, it creates employment, they get to know who we are, some might identify even opportunities, they come back, invest, and it affects the local economy.
That's right.
Now, on the other side of what you were trying to say in terms of who actually gets the revenue and so on and so forth, look, accounting is what a double entry, bookkeeping activity. You have to talk of revenue much the same way as you also talk about what expenditure. We don't know what the expenditure really is, so we can't really be talking about the profit and so on and so forth. If you're not going to share in losses, why care about profit? Now, what I'm trying to say really is that until
I get you
we
exactly.
have,
we're finance people, so
yeah, until
I get
we've really gone to the point where we've seen a real blueprint of this went into it, and therefore this is what we generated, and this is what we got to do in order to really scale up, upscale what we got from last year, we will not be able to, talk much about. But let me say that I am so happy, I'm excited all the time when the local economy is benefiting. Mm-hmm. Now, when the EIB group took charge of that Kwewu market, that could be the first time people are hearing of the EIB. In a way, that is a market driver for EIB as a group. Now, for the locals, this is an opportunity for them. Car park attendants, waitresses, choba operators, even to the basic barber. This is an opportunity for them to find a few bushy-haired people from Accra, for them
and
to do justice
them,
to the IR, so on and so forth. There's a whole lot of excitement, and that multiplier effect must not be limited to how much goes into the national kitty, but how much joy the people at the local level have really been able to experience.
I'm sure, Pat John, I will not be fair to you if I skip this question off and talk about the best practice, that you are also there, a practitioner in the industry, an advocate in the industry. How can we make it better? How can we enhance it? He's touched on a lot. I mean, close to 10 minutes of delivery. Give me your take on it also.
Well, there is very much more I can add to what he said, because indeed, that is how it has to be looked at. How can we make it better? Organizing it, we have a lot of... for instance, the ministry was doing the paragliding at the top in ATBA. In other towns and the communities there, all the parties and things were going on. It was a very interesting thing driving through the whole place, the whole area. And this is not something that you can replicate any time or any other time of the year, because Easter is a time when the people of Kwewu themselves believe to be a time for them to do a homecoming. So it's a homecoming situation where the people who have gone and are settled all over the country come home, come with their friends, and because of the added value of the paragliding and EIB,
yeah.
The promotion that it got from last year and year. If you even mentioned Abuachiri. Time was when Abuachiri was the flavor of tourism in this country.
I mean, I'm sure you are from the central region. And
well, I'm from the western region,
Redstone,
but yes,
okay.
Everybody was looking forward to going to Abuachiri. And chieftaincy disputes have halted this.
Crippled. But hey, Homowo is still doing well.
Yes.
Hogbechocho is still doing well. So can we not rebrand some of these wonderful festivals? The Fire Festival in the northern part of the country. It all has traditional...
I think the media has a lot to do with these
culturally?
Things.
Culturally?
Yes.
Culturally?
I think... finish with this point, that the media has a lot to do with this thing. If EIB hadn't gone in and made the kind of impact that you did with all the noise...
That's right.
This festival would have gone on with a lot of people, a lot of indigenes, like how the Fire Festival, the people from the north, because it's far, not a whole lot can go, but a lot of people go. the Abuachi and everything, they will still go. But if the media does not blow it up like we did this with one, you can't get, you know, as far as...
So you believe as a media we should take interest in every one of them and help promote
If even if we select a festival, because every region in this country has a festival, and even if we can select one festival, you know, at a time, and the media promote each of these festivals, we can get a lot more people going to these communities and building on the economy of these communities by going to a barber, buying Kofi Brookman. All these little things you think is small money, but they add up, and then they give that community some economy, and the people there are happier for your coming, you know.
Of course, so it could be the Homo War, it could be the Hogwechocho. If we invest a lot in it, if we talk about it more, if we rebrand it so well, I'm sure it would go a long way to benefit the indigenes and indeed the cultural setup of the community. If you're just joining us, you're live on State of Affairs. My name is Kweku Temin. I'm sitting in for Nanaba Anamoah. At this point, we'll take a breather. When we come back, we'll delve deep into other areas of tourism in the country. Do stay with us. We'll be back shortly. All right, so we're grateful that you're still with us on State of Affairs. We're looking at some developments around the tourism sector. If you want to know, my guest in the studio, Dr. Bernard Otabel, he's the CEO of the Ghana News Agency. I also have Pa John Bentefi. Pa John is the principal of the Sea Ghana Domestic Tourism Crusade. Indeed, they are looking at driving domestic tourism in the country. But we would want to just quickly look at some statistics, and I'm looking at countries that are indeed raking good revenue from the tourism sector. I'll just get some figures from 2014 because I've not had to close the 2015 figures. So we're looking at France raking as much as $83.7 million from its tourism visitation. I'm sure Eiffel Tower and the like comes in strong. Everybody wants to go to France, Paris, and see this tower. United States also gains a lot from tourism, $74.8 million, and it follows with Spain, China, Italy, Turkey, and the like. Dubai indeed raking in a lot from tourism. Very shortly, we've had them visit these countries. They'll share with us what is unique about these countries. They are going there, what they actually saw. But let me try to find out if I could easily catch Ghana somewhere. We're also doing a lot with Hogwechocho and Kwewu Easter and the like. Let's see if we rank top 10. So in Africa, we have Morocco coming first. $10.2 million. We're looking also at South Africa. Indeed, it's amazing. South Africa, indeed, driving tourism a lot. Tunisia, Algeria, Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Kenya. Of course, when you talk about the waterfalls and the likes of the various parks in and around Kenya, it tells you that they are also driving tourism a lot. Uganda, Namibia, and then I'd move on and look at Senegal. Where is Ghana? Gentlemen, at this point, I'm disappointed.
You know, you're talking about South Africa. A few years ago, when there was a global slump in the economies, South Africa got a hit as well. What did they do with their tourism? They even lowered tariffs and went on a marketing blitz around the world. They went to all the international exhibitions and Emporia and promoted South Africa, and they had lowered all their tariffs, so hotel bills, airline, everything was lower.
So this and was a pragmatic approach to woo people.
It was government-led, and they wooed people, and people sat in airline, flew to South Africa, and experienced the country.
Even though the economic turbulence around the time was not favorable for anybody.
Even now, it isn't over yet, but if you listen to the news and the radio in Ghana, South African Airlines is advertising heavily, promoting South Africa. The jazz concerts, come and see the people, come and see Mandela's prison room, Robben Island. It's in your face, even here in Ghana, let alone going there. So it's what we've been saying. It's the will of the government, the political will to push the agenda. That's what we're lacking in this country. And that's what makes...
What is the Chinese doing right? You were there not too long ago. You can give me vivid pictures. Today we want to learn and pick their best practice. Why is it that I have mentioned all these countries have come to Africa and my beloved mother country, Ghana, is nowhere? Are you equally disappointed like I am? You are.
Disappointment is quite a bit of a strong, you know, word in that sense. But I would say that I'm not happy.
And that then you are disappointed.
That is not different. That is very different from being disappointed. I mean, if you look at what South Africa, like he mentioned, what they have done over the years. If you look at a place like Sun City, where I've been a few times, I mean, this was a specially built city. If you go to Sun City, you land in Sun City.
When you finish describing Sun City, I want you to compare it to a place here in Ghana that we can, as a people, decide that, look, we want to build this area to meet the standard. Of course, we should have a vision. So go ahead. You just...
Well, you know, when you go to Sun City, what you find in Sun City is amazing. Amazing in the sense that even the way the architecture is done, they have in there, in the middle there somewhere, where they've actually created a lake. So within that, you can even go there, do a whole lot of water sports and, you know, so on and so forth. Things that you can easily do at our numerous beaches. Look at the coastline of you know, of Ghana, for example. Yeah. You don't need to create another Sun City in order to enjoy that experience. You have people who go and build their hotels, and they call it what, sea view, and there's no water sports. So basically where you go is you just watch the skyline, have a high-rise building, get a bit of sea breeze. Even that, we go to the sea view hotels and we still use air conditioning. So you don't normally get what you are supposed to get when you go to such places. It is just that, you know, kind of concerted effort in ensuring that indeed we look at this industry as the engine of growth. Now, in the South African economy, for example, today, I mean, what he mentioned, they have no other choice. Now, if you go to South Africa today, they're sort of, you know, as it were, doomsayer they are experiencing now. If you read the narratives of South Africa today, you might think, without reading the headline, you might think you are reading about Ghana. Industries are not doing so well. And even, in fact, commodity prices are falling globally. And the tourism industry is the only industry globally that has helped in the face of dwindling commodity prices globally. That has helped a lot of people to actually withstand a lot of exogenous, you know, shocks that had come about as a result of the global slump, as it were. Now, France, US, and China, as you mentioned, China has moved from the fifth level in global tourism revenue to the third, according to the 2014 statistics, what is the most current. Now, what are they doing right? They're doing a lot right. Before you even go to China or conceive of going to China, the Chinese have managed to sell you Chinese food in Ghana. So therefore, you have that kind of cultural kind of affinity. That even though you haven't been to China, you think you have eaten Chinese. And therefore, when you go to China, you are looking for the best oriental...
Don't forget, we've consumed, you know, a lot of kung fu.
Well, I was just going to come to that. You know, from the ping pong, the table tennis and all of that. Yeah. So I was there. I went to the kung fu, whatever they call it. Mm-hmm. We watched an afternoon kung fu and all of that. We learned about the Chinese culture. Many. I did the Great Wall of China. Fantastic. You know, and you realize that indeed, the rich culture of the Chinese, and there's a lot that you really would want to learn from the Chinese, you know, in so many ways. So once you get there, there is so much that you find, you know, in awe of.
Could we have had bits and pieces we could have even sold on the African continent alone? That this one is our pride.
We have a lot of pride. I mean, in Botswana, I can give you a typical example. In Botswana, when I was in Gaborone, for example, there as a tourist, there's a lot that you can see. Driving from Gaborone to Lubache, along the road, you see the monkeys, you see all kinds of wildlife, real. Now, if you're doing a kakum, you know, canopy walk, and you hardly even find a bird, you know, to sing to you, to whisper to you, then you have a problem. Now, in the Southern African bit, what they've had, you know, money to do the safaris, you know, the, what do you call that, the wildlife. And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, a buzz that goes with that. And because of that, a lot of people, especially the European, you know, do really find that Southern African, you know, kind of tourism much more attractive. You know, you do Kenya. Yeah, I didn't really, you know, have the chance to do much in Kenya. The only thing was play golf at the Windsor Castle. And the Windsor is a very fantastic, nice place. And you go there, you stay there. From there on, you move to, you know, and because of the kind of topography, the kind of system that we have all around Africa, Africans don't normally find African tourism that much exciting. But the weather permitting, most Southern African countries seem to attract, you know, a lot of these Europeans, and that is why they keep, you know, developing their facilities and creating that kind of ripple effect, you know, all across.
Interestingly, Ghana seems to be one country where, even though we're in West Africa, the topography of Ghana also lends itself to myriad tourism opportunities. We actually have safari in the north. We have some wildlife. We have,
of course, when you've been to the Mole parks and everything.
Mole park, and recently with the new five-star facility is a tented hotel, Zainer Lodge, which actually, you know, all the people who have gone to Zainer Lodge I've met and have come. It's expensive, but they say it's so much worth it because the sort of experience you get, the welcome from the staff at the hotel, the food is you know, world class. Wow. The safari they give you, and the interesting thing is that in Mole, you can do three or four different kinds of safari.
Do you realize that the workers are not mostly Ghanaians? Of course, those who would meet you firsthand and the like.
In Ghana?
Indians, you know.
Well, it is run by Indians. It's owned by an American and Ghanaian investors. I know that. But the staff are taken from all over Ghana. They're not just people from the north. Okay. And I met somebody who was from Cape Coast, Sridru. Somebody was from the Volta region, you know, they were all working and living there. And they've been trained. I mean, when you get there, the sort of welcome they give you, I mean, it's as if once you think that I want to have this, they are there and they're giving it to you. They just give you an experience that is comparable to any in the world.
I like the passion and with which you talk about this facility, five-star facility. That does it ring a bell then that we're losing a lot also because of improper customer service?
Yes, the passion is not necessarily to talk about Zainer,
sell them,
but the fact that indeed it can be done in Ghana. Because these are Ghanaians who are doing this. They've been trained to do it, and they're doing it fantastically. But when you go to other facilities, you don't get that level of attention, that level of service. And the questions begin. Why is it that you can get this here and you can't get this there? And, you know, it's
I love when Golden Bean. I love Golden Bean. They managed to help me get you come to my studio tonight. So I'll give it to them, Amaka and his team. But just when you're wrapping up, I'd also want to come to Dr. Otabel. So maybe let me give you a minute more to just close the chapter. You're talking about the topography of this country and how it presents
When you come to the south, you have the sea, you have the beaches, and we can have all the sun, sea thing that, you know, tourists like. But that is not what tourists who are coming to Africa, who are coming to Ghana, necessarily want. Because they can get that, especially in Europe, equally there. What they want to do in Ghana is interact with the people. Is seeing the people, our culture, how we live, how the things we eat. Those are the things that fascinate the tourists who come there. And our festivals. Our festivals are a great pool. And a lot of foreigners who come are really, really excited to see how these festivals have come about and how our traditions and how our customs are practiced. And these are the things that they want to see and share, live with the people. A lot of them want to even do home stays and live with the people and actually see how we live. Because you know that.
Also, move away from the hotel environment. Come into a proper Ghanaian home. And
There's a new accommodation service going on in the world called, I forget the name, but it's an online thing. You go online and then it's people's homes.
You look for a home
that where you live with actually, the family. Yeah, you go and live with the people. Sometimes the people don't live in the country. Maybe they travel, they're working elsewhere, but they've put their home up. And it's like a hotel. You go and then you live there, you pay. You know, people want to move away from the traditional hotel setup and actually experience the people in the countries that they visit. And we have to recognize these things and build our tourism in that line. Ghana has a very, very rich people-centered tourism that we can offer. And we have to really look at that and develop it. And one includes this festival that just happened over the weekend, because a lot of people went up there to experience other people. Why did we go? I mean, it's just about, you know, interacting with
Dr. Tabel. Let me come to the finance bits once again. The selling point here in Ghana. I mean, I'll give you a simple one, which I'm not from Malaysia. I've not been there. But you say Malaysia, and I'll tell you truly Asia. Have we sold ourselves as a country to the world very well? Is there something that we can be marked for? If there's not, and you think there's a particular area that we can look at as a people and hit hard and use that as a diving board, I'd want you to share with me.
What I would say is pretty simple. I mean, our opportunities and our challenges in the sector are very well documented. I mean, I would say sometimes it becomes a no-brainer if you keep, you know, listing these things over and over again. Now, I would rather call for political will. The president gave a State of the Nation address, and if you look at a State of the Nation address, I believe it's about a 56-page document, which I went through every bit of it. Now, there was no mention of the tourism sector in there, and, you know, I stand to be corrected. The only thing that was akin to the tourism sector was probably when a special mention was made on the economy, and then the services sector came up for special mention. That is contributed about 50% to our GDP, which made a very good, you know, quick juxtaposing with the situation at the time of independence.
Even now, the century,
he just wants to add a little bit and then you can continue.
Yes, I mean, you see, that is what I would say on that part. So I would call for that political will. Now, I've also cited that 15-year development plan, which starts from 2013 to 2027. Now, I think that also is about 326-page document, which has a lot of consultations done over the years, supported with money and all kinds of stakeholder engagements. Now, I am rather calling for the good things that have so much been stated in there to be implemented. Now, if you have given me a plan that gives me 4.3 or 4.5 billion in receipts from tourism by 2027, that is what I want to see actualized. If you're giving me a plan that is giving me about $1.5 billion by 2017, that is what I want to see actualized. That political will must be, you know, seen running through for the tourism sector to be taken, you know, in the sense that we are describing it now. Because we've looked at it in various areas. We've dissected all the problems. We look at all the opportunities. And you mentioned Malaysia, truly Asia. South Africa, they all came up with a very nice, you know, catchphrases. Yeah. And the moment you mention it, you realize that, look, I want to really go and see what exactly is there. And once that really caught on with people, people want to find out what is exactly at that destination. And that is when they will come. They don't go to, you know, just go to a place to visit and just go and lie on a beach and drink coconut. They would also want to take part in some activities. We have some of the best, most beautiful, you know, birds in Africa, in this country. People will go for bird watching. You know, they can easily come and say, you promise them that, look, if you go into the monkey sanctuary, you will see
the water region
and all of that. People just go for bird watching. They love it. See the different species taking pictures and all of that. Where has that gone? I wouldn't want to really advocate for anything more than what they've already put on paper. Let's see the political will. Let's see tourism seen as indeed the fourth largest revenue earner. If you take out fuels, you know, chemicals, and the food industry, tourism comes fourth. And that is the global statistics. And that is something that we don't need to really lose sight of. And as a country,
Pajon,
it can help us in many ways.
Gateway to Africa. Are there inputs, gateway to Africa?
You know, the 15-year tourism development plan. The first one. That was what brought about CEDICOM, which was the Central Regional Development Bank.
PANAFEST
also came out of it.
I remember I was so young, but it was so powerful.
It was so powerful.
1996.
There was Intertourism,
right.
Which was the exhibition that was being done at the trade fair. And it was highlighting what we have in this country.
Yeah.
In this country. And we were all excited, and we were told in 15 years we're going to rake in $1 million at the time. And we thought it was a huge sum of money, and we were excited. And we're like, great, you know, let's move it. And the political will was there because it was, I think it was Jerry Rawlings' time where he pushed
for all
the champion this very, very, very much. He understood what this meant for the people. And he championed it and pushed it. And we had other political dispensations, you know, even the Kwewu thing came from one of that.
Yeah, from
and since then, you know, it seems
you think political will is dying? You're saying it's dead?
I think it's dead. There was no mention of tourism in the last State of the Nation address. I also stand to be corrected. And in the Senchi document that came up a few years ago, also...
You didn't see any significant touch on tourism. A fourth aspect worrying. To your GDP, yes. Economy.
That's worrying. And if that doesn't mean it's dead, I don't know what else it is. For me, as a layman, you know, if you are in certain circles and you've cited certain documents, and then you know that, okay, something is happening. But for us here, we don't know what's going on.
Pajon, a tourism advocate, has said it here on the State of Affairs that tourism, he thinks, is dead. Dr. Otabel, tourism is dead.
No, not tourism.
You're just very cautious about it.
I don't think he said tourism is dead.
No, that's
well, you know, pardon me. I mean, and,
let's face it.
And,
I mean,
you know,
tourism is wobbling.
Well, wobbling pretty, but let me say that as a financier, I go by the figures. The figures in front of me, I mean, do not really speak to a dead, you know, industry.
Exactly, yeah.
Now, if you look at the foreign aid contribution to GDP, tourism does about 3.5, and now
but
the target
that,
is about
5%. That is autopilot, where you don't even do anything and they come in anyway. The few who come in, so when they come in, you wreck some few CDs from them, and you're not putting in much effort. Autopilot.
There was an effort in the early 1990s when tourism arrivals was about 400 and something thousand annually. There was a plan in place that actually looked at generating 1 million receipts by a set target date. And these are also well documented. So efforts were put in. And now what I would even say that if you look at what the president said in his address, or I think on the 6th of March, when he talked about the fact that there's no visa
for Africans,
which this is going to be, if we manage it properly with all the security risks and all of that, it's going to be a very big driver for the tourism sector. So this is one of the areas that...
It's a thumbs up for policy in this country.
In this direction.
To the African...
Regional integration. I mean, it's a very key part. You know, we used to have a Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but we looked at regional integration and said, well, it is a very key component of our foreign relation activities. And we brought it in, this, and now we're going to be the second country in Africa to introduce such a policy. And the president said it was on the 6th of March. I think that we can hold him to it, and it's something that is quite, you know, eager to get it done. That is also an area that you can say is going to drive in, you know, tourism receipts and all of that. So I can't really, you know, at this stage say that, well, it's dead or, you know, otherwise. No, it's really something that is targeted, but the political will must be, you know, energized in a much, you know, in a much proper way to ensure that indeed, even if we make our tourism minister, cabinet minister, or whatever, then we know that we look at the receipt for foreign exchange as something that would also help us to have our currency depreciation, you know, stopped. Mm-hmm. Because where you have so much, you know, in terms of foreign exchange to be spent on import, and you don't have the equivalent receipt, then you have a problem. You know, it's a very simple, you know, economic analysis, where you have more money chasing a few goods and the reverse, and so on and so forth. So, pretty much, I think it's something that we got to look at.
I like your confidence in the industry, Pajon. I'll come to you as we prepare to round the discussions up. And here, I dare say that putting up activities around domestic tourism is quite difficult. But touch on the international one. How can we sell ourselves out there and juxtapose it by your local activities that you're putting in?
Well, I think that participating in the international exhibitions that the ministry, for instance, and the tourist authority actually do now is one way of putting what we have in Ghana out there. Mm. And that, like Dr. Otobe was
saying...
Give me
typical examples. Look,
There's an ITB in London, International Tourism Market, ITM.
No, World Tourism Market.
World Tourism, okay. Sorry, WTM in London every November. ITB is an international tourism something. It happens in Europe, in mainland Europe. You know, there's so many of them. And now I understand that the ministry is also going to be marketing Ghana in China because the Asians also want to come. If we're able to succeed in marketing Ghana to the Asians properly, we're going to increase receipts, people arrivals, which is going to be very, very good for us. But for me, I think that one of the first areas too that we must actually look, because really, if we look at a downturn in terms of a negative thing happening in West Africa, when they mention West Africa, there's all these things happening in Ivory Coast, Burkina Faso, which are neighboring countries.
Of course, this is a major they affect us. To us.
Yes. Yeah. And if it affects us in a way that the international market says they won't come here, we still have our facilities, which still need to be
patronized.
And if we are able to give the local people a taste of what they have, they being in the country and knowing that it's relatively safe, will continue to patronize these facilities. And the cycle
and
will continue.
And hold the fort
till we're able to...
The fever dies out of this scale.
And that's why I'm very keen on promoting domestic tourism. Because if we don't get us to have that feel, have that taste...
You've exhausted the time, but if I could plead for 2 minutes for you, what do you think can be done for a person like you to help that initiative? What, because yes, on your own, you spend money on air, promote it, and at the end of the day, a father even says, look, I can't guarantee you going. So the kid pulls out, even though they are interested.
Yeah.
What can be done for you to drive this?
Well, I mean, obviously, if the facilities and the factors that lead to the logistics of putting these things together are made a little easier, or there's some sort of assistance from government. I mean, the ministry itself, I'm very glad that the minister herself is very, very dedicated and interested in domestic tourism, because she's also launched the Explore Ghana program, which is a domestic tourism
initiative
yeah. by the ministry herself, the minister herself. Yeah. And she gets people, especially, if you like, celebrities, visiting all these attractions, so that there's news coming out of there for people to hear about the attractions, and you know, and then you drive people there. But what I'm also doing is taking ordinary people. And if...
Maybe you might want to add one or two of us at the end of the day.
Why not? Why not? You know,
I'm sure my colleague Nanaba would gladly
take ordinary
join
people,
some few.
Yes, and then, you know, be able to,
then he goes so that his news...
be able to put all the activities and the hiking, the excursions, everything that you do on television, in the newspapers, talk about it on radio. That's, you know, so I'm doing this with Joy FM, Joy Prime on Mochi TV, and the Mirror newspaper. So every time that we go, these media will propagate what we'll be doing. And I mean, it's interesting that it's only yesterday that we came from Kweu, and I went with locals, people who live in Accra, who have never thought of Kweu in that sense, or haven't had the, you know, there's a Fajato, there's this, there's that. But when we went to Kweu and the number of activities that was going on in, you know, they were just fascinated.
The 2 minutes, I'm sure. I mean, it's quite done. Dr. Tabel, let me tell you about an interesting detail that I picked up and how we can rectify. You know the gentleman with the Kweu paragliding who had to learn the piloting? Yeah. He actually had to sell his own car and then travel there. I mean, is it far from right that the ministry would pick
someone
5-10 indigents and say, look, the pilots come in, we want to support you. Now, I have seen a country like Sierra Leone decide, or Sierra Leone again, decide to come and train pilots here at the Kotoka International Airport. No, they don't have an aircraft, but they decide that, look, in the near future, we'd want our citizenry to have experience in this area. Our nautical college, we have some African countries, just now it's a regional maritime academy, planning to bring in their indigenous to come and learn. They might not have a vessel yet, but they think it is crucial for their system of education. So go in there and train. And if it's feasible, let's come and inculcate it in our country. Now you have this good thing, not once, not twice, not the fourth time. Paragliding is going on, Kweu Easter festivities, years now, and we only have one pilot.
Well, I think that you are spot on that. I mean, it's a good, you know, pick in terms of the fact that, yes, innovation is the highest kite one can fly. And you don't wait for the rains to set in before you start, you know, looking for where your umbrella is. Make sure you got it where it is, so that when the rains set in, you know exactly where to find it. Now, I believe that, and I also see the direction that the ministry is taking the tourism sector today. Probably could be something that, you know, they will consider. I think it's something that, you know, might come up, you know, at some point, because of what I've seen and what I've read and what I'm associated with one way or the other. So, yes, the gentleman has done well. He's given us, you know, some food for thought.
And
I believe that is something that the ministry will have to pick it up and encourage more people to take part in such a very, you know, laudable kind of initiative. Now, in our initial submission, we had looked at whether indeed we would have, or we would make more money, or would have made money in the whole thing that took place in Kwa. But we also said, well, we don't know what we spent
on those who came in.
If we know that everything's going to stay local, then it doesn't matter what was spent or what was saved. At the end of the day, the money still sits here, and we would, you know, be able to use it the best way that, you know, we want to use it. And I'm all for it. And I believe that now the ministry will have to take it up if they haven't already, you know, considered such an initiative. And let's get more people to show more interest in such an initiative.
All right, so let's get more people to show more interest. And sometimes when you're supporting the few who brave themselves and take the initiative up, then obviously when it comes back to you, definitely then you would want to see support coming to you. Gentlemen, I'll take in a break shortly. But before then, I would want us to come back to training. Facilities that train indigenous. We talked about the hospitality sector. I mean, I'm looking for that institution that will train waiters. I mean, you learn by the wayside, or you have one director just showing you what to do. But I want to see people being given certificates in this area. After this break, when we come back, we'll be looking at that development, indeed training in this sector. We'll be back shortly. Do stay with us. If you're just joining us, you're still live on State of Affairs. We've been talking about the developments in the tourism sector, and tonight we expect to spend a little more time on it before we round it up exactly at 8:30. But you should trust that GH1 Television should be that official channel that will bring you every bit of the details that you should expect in the 2016 election. Already we've started, and elections pollster Benef Sin is joining us with the countdown.
Write it down. A P A T H Y. That's apathy. Apathy basically refers to a situation. There are a few characteristics. One, it happens in your backyard, where it is your stronghold. Does it happen in a street constituency? No. You are not sure. It doesn't happen in your opponent's stronghold, because you know that what they could have been a local feel bad. It often happens in your backyard, where you are strong. Apathy is what we determine as you can't be bothered. So like in Clotically, if Ninoy decides not to contest at all, there'll be a lot of apathy among his supporters. So in areas that, let's say 2012, for example, NDC won Clotically by about 1,300 votes. So you know that the elections, whoever wins, should be 1,200, 2,000 votes. If Ninoy decides not to go, there'll be apathy among the MPP supporters. They will not turn up. So when the results are announced, you see this time the MPP has lost, not by 2,000 or 1,200, 1,300, they've lost by 5,000. In 2000, there were problems in the Volta region, which is known as the Vodka Well Bank of the NDC. The NDC took it for granted that, oh yes, they win the seats. It affected them. 2008, there was apathy among most of the MPP supporters in the Ashanti region, which they are political stronghold, did not bother to deal with it. When Sun had missed Gary, people had been apathetic. They went around begging, and it was too late. So if you belong to a political party and you're having problems in your backyard, don't fold your arms there. Oh, win the seat is easy. When elections can be won by less than 41,000 votes, don't joke. Apathy is a cancer that eats political parties when supporters refuse to turn up to vote. Commander Edina Eguafo Ibrahim, KEEA. If Dr. Atukwasi had not contested as an independent candidate, most of the 15,000 NDC persons who voted for him and voted for President Dramama wouldn't have turned out to vote. This is apathy. They can't be bothered. The same thing happened. If you look at the results in 2004, you would see that the first round, there was such a high level of apathy. In 2008 first round, the MPP, that Nana Akufo-Addo, got 72.4%. The NDC got 26.1%. They went round, they pleaded, and the runoff, it jumped to 75%. And the NDC dropped to 25%. It tells you that certain MPP members were angry and voted for Professor Moss. That is how apathy affects you. Apathy is when people will not even turn out or may decide to punish you. So the little advice I give political parties, if you have a stronghold and you hear of little problems popping up, don't think that is a done deal. People will just say, hello, honorable, do not bother. Elections can be close, and people take so much strength out of it. I think this election should be close. I think that it would be cleaner, and people's eyes would be more open. But be careful of the word apathy. APATH.
Elections pollster Ben Efsen, and I'm proud to say he is associated with EIB. Definitely election 2016. He'll be bringing you all the details, and you would get it right on this network. Well, gentlemen, I'm just preparing to run the program up. It's been very interesting. Just then, Pajon, your final words.
I think...
I don't know if apathy has set in with tourism.
not yet. I think the stimulation is there.
Okay, so your
a lot more words. People are getting more and more interested in the domestic. The domestic market is building up. I think training, like we're talking about, training of hospitality staff is very, very key. And I think that promotion, the media, who have the wherewithal, should show more interest and promote the festivals, especially, and things that we have. And I think the ministry, as they've started, should continue with the Explore Ghana project, the Explore Ghana initiative. And where necessary, support people like myself. You know, there are a lot of other young companies around who are doing these things. Right. Transportation is a big deal. We don't have a coach company with coaches sitting there where you can just go and hire and take people out. You know, you're going to private companies and they charge you an arm and a leg. You know, all these
Pajon
things.
Pajon has made the point there. Dr. Otabel.
Oh, well. A very final word.
A very final word.
Apathy set in already? No. Or you think we have not gotten there yet?
I mean, that was a very interesting
one. Well, you can comment on it.
Well, I mean, I think Efsen, you know, Ben Efsen has, you know, really touched on it quite well. I mean, and I would want to relate it to what happened in the UK. I mean, the Liberal Democrats and the Conservatives formed the government, the Libcon, you know, government. And when the voters got really fed up with what had happened eventually, because you know what? In times past, by the way you spoke, by the dress you wore, we could tell which political ideology you belong to. Today we have Mercedes-Benz driving socialists, so you don't even know what exactly is going on. So when when the voters really realize that, look, we voted for Liberal Democrat, they've gone to join a conservative, we are diametrically opposed in all the things that you look at our policies. They punish them at the local, government elections. And then in the general elections, you saw what happened. That's the Lib Dem, even the Green Party and all these, independent candidates were coming up quite strongly. Now the president has realized, he's a very astute politician, just a few days, I think 2 days ago, he was telling the people, do not just stay there and say, EDB, okay, just get out there and vote, preventing apathy. Now, let's come back to tourism. Now, in the area of training, as my colleague rightly pointed out, it's very important that those in the industry,
I only have 30 seconds,
appreciate what, training, would do to the industry going forward. And I believe that there's a need for more training schools to be, to be brought up in a way that would ensure that we strengthen the industry and make it to become what we've anticipated it to be in the policy document that we have.
Dr. Bernard Otabel is the CEO of the Ghana News Agency. I've also been interacting with Pa John Bentefi, who is the principal of the See Ghana Domestic Tourism Crusade. Gentlemen.
As well, that's Pa John Bentefi
Datsun. Okay, yeah. So I've added the Datsun. Pa John Bentefi Datsun. Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. But to you out there, let me even appreciate you better for spending all this time with us. Indeed, tomorrow, Nanaba Anamoa joins you with some more on State of Affairs. My name is Kwaku Timin. Pleasure serving you this evening. A very good evening.